So we start? Okay. Good. Yesterday I showed you LDA plus DMFT, the practicalities of LDA plus DMFT, how to do this on the computer yourself. I stopped with discussing a little bit total energies, or how you do this full self-consistent LDA plus DMFT. What I want to do today is to show you a general framework, how to be able to write down the expression for these total energies. And all this is related to functional representations of these theories. So it's all about functionals today. That's also the reason why I switched slots with Silke, because she will rely a lot also on functionals to derive all these GW expressions and GW plus DMFT. So we found it quite good that I introduced to you this concept of writing down these functionals and what you can learn doing these manipulations. So what do I mean with functionals? What we want to have at the end of the day is some property gamma, that is what we call the functional, and this depends on some local quantity. And for instance, if we do just standard mean field theory, we would say the functional should depend only on the local magnetization. That's the property that we deal with in mean field theory. If we think of DMFT, then this should be a functional only of the Green's function, the local Green's function. That's the property, the central property of DMFT, as Antoine and many other people already explained to you. So that's in the self-consistency condition and so on. So, for instance, if what you will see later on, if you put here also the screened interaction, you will end up with GW plus DMFT. And what we want to do at the end of the day, we want to have something which has the Green's function and the local density, and that will be DFT plus DMFT. So, and I want to show you how you can construct these kind of functionals and how you can manipulate these objects. It's a very basic concept. It's very useful for many things, so not only for this. Okay, so maybe, one more thing. All this is related to these so-called equivalent systems. So these equivalent systems are systems which are defined only for local quantities but give you exactly the same physics. So that's the mapping from, let's say, the Hubbard model to the Anderson impurity model, or from the interacting Ising spins to single spins in effective media, in effective mean fields. So, and I will show you that this mapping is exact. It's not the mapping that's the problem, it's then the approximations that you do to the self-consistency that gives you the approximate nature of these solutions. So all this is about equivalent systems. So here we will see it's a single spin in an effective medium. Here it's a Green's function on one side in an effective bath, in a dynamical bath. So that's the general idea. Okay, to show you how these things work, I will start with the classical Ising. It's the Ising model with Hamiltonian minus sum over ij, jij, sigma I, sigma j. So this is the model that we start with, and we want something, as I said, which depends not on Si, Sj, on the interaction, but it depends only on the local magnetization that is defined by this Hamiltonian. Okay. This we skip. Yeah. What one can do then also at the end of the day when we constructed this is the equilibrium solution, so the equilibrium state that is defined as the ground state of the Hamiltonian is given by the stationary point of this functional with respect to the m. So the variations of gamma with m when they are zero, that gives you the equilibrium state. So that is how you can define all these kind of mean field theories, and you will see how this works. Okay, I will use something that's called the coupling constant integration method for this. Coupling constant integration. That means some part of the Hamiltonian will have some coupling constant that we integrate between zero, that's then the equivalent problem, what we call the equivalent problem, and one, which will be the original problem. So you can go continuously between these two. And in our case, it's very simple. So we call something H alpha. So alpha will be the coupling constant. And here we have no choice, so we put it just in front of the Hamiltonian. Sigma I, sigma j. So you see what it means. If alpha is 1, you recover the original Hamiltonian. If alpha is 0, H is 0, so that's a free spin in the vacuum. There's no interaction between the two guys. Now we define a functional, let's call it omega, that depends on m. I write here lambda I will tell you what this means, and alpha, m lambda alpha. And this should be a free energy, so it's minus 1 over beta trace logarithm e to the minus beta h alpha. And now comes something, I write it down and then maybe you tell me what it is. What is such a term? It's a Legendre multiplier. These lambdas are Legendre multiplier, Lagrange, not Legendre, Lagrange multiplier, sorry. This term, in a sense, is the free energy, and this ensures that the magnetization is the expectation value of S. And how you see this, that this is something with free energy, and this ensures the magnetization. So you can do a manipulation. Now you have to be careful. This is an operator. This is an operator. This is a number. The MI are numbers. They are expectation values. So this product of beta, lambda, I, MI is just a number. So you can put it wherever you want. You can shift it back and forth. That's no problem. So you can put beta, lambda, I, MI out of the exponential. So you can write this as e to the minus beta h alpha plus beta sum over I lambda I s I. But then write e to the lambda I m I sum over I beta. So since this is not an operator, you can just split this two exponent, the argument in these two exponentials. Now here is a logarithm and a trace. And the logarithm of the product of two exponentials, you can also split this apart. And at the end of the day, what you find is that this you can split off. You have here the free energy, which depends on lambda. It depends, of course, on this alpha, which is a parameter. And now you have some I, lambda I, MI. So this question. Is a general functional, yes?
Isn't the coupling included in J itself? Like, why are we introducing alpha?
No, okay. Here it's a bit arbitrary because there is only one energy scale. So you could also say, okay, instead of alpha, I take J, let it go to 0 and let it go back to 1. But to have it general, because later on we will see that the Hamiltonian consists of two parts, and now you want to scale only one with alpha and the other one not. And so you write an addition constant that you vary from 0 to 1 to get from the non-interacting to the interacting problem. But of course, here in this case, alpha times j is just the j tilde, and you could use this. Okay, and as I said, this Lagrange multiplier ensures that if you calculate d omega over d lambda I, what happens is that this derivative takes this object, puts it down here in front of the trace, so that's nothing else than the expectation value, and then you have expectation value S I minus M I. This is just evaluating this. This is a number, this is an operator, so you can write it expectation value S minus M I. If you require that this is 0, you see this ensures that the magnetization that you impose, the MI, is equivalent to the expectation value of the spin on this side. That's the whole thing about this Lagrange multiplier. So you can enforce the average of a dynamic variable to a certain value. That's MI that we impose. Okay, now comes a bit the tricky part, and you have to follow me. This equation, you can use to invert the dependence on lambda. So that allows to express the lambdas, the Lagrange multipliers as function of m. So if you remember the things that you learned in mathematics, you always replace then the Lagrange multipliers with some inverse expression. So you replace lambda by lambda as function of m, the thing that you had, that you required to be. So you can somehow eliminate the lambdas in all these formulas. And by doing this, we get this functional that we want, which is gamma. Let's give it an index alpha. Now, I don't write it now as functional of lambda, but as functional of m only. So this depends only on m. And this is omega, the one that we had, mi. And now we had here lambda, but let's express this as, all this is formal. This is just a formal inversion of the problem. Alpha plus some I lambda I of m mi. So you see this is exactly the structure of a Legendre transform in thermodynamics. You always have this kind of, you have one potential here that depends on m, the other one that depends on the conjugate variable, and then you express the variable to the other one, and you plus or minus depending on how you define things, for instance Ts, entropy and temperature. That's exactly the Legendre transform that it's written here. Okay, the goal is now to calculate gamma of alpha equal to 1 as function of the m. This is not really working. This we want to calculate, this property, because that is the original Hamiltonian. But this we don't do directly, because that's complicated. What we do is, we start, we get this by starting from gamma alpha equal to 0, and then integrating our way up to alpha equal to 1. That's the concept of coupling constant integration. That is a quite general concept that you can find in many things in statistical physics, also in thermodynamics. So I will show you how this works here. So what does it mean? We start with alpha equal to 0. We have to calculate this functional for alpha equal to 0 first. And how does this work? It's very easy, because we just take this expression and set alpha equal to 0. What does that mean? This goes away completely. H alpha for alpha equal to 0 is 0. So we can write, I go directly here, we can write omega, let's start with omega, as 1 over beta logarithm trace e to the minus, and what's left? Yes, we will see that what this allows is to systematically calculate mean field approximations. That means you have the equivalent problem, which is exactly the alpha equal to 0 case. And then by integrating from 0 to 1, you get what for DFT will be the exchange correlation part. So you can really identify things, approximations. So you have a 0 part, you have a mean field part, you have something that's beyond mean field. So you will see all these parts properly, how they appear in this calculation. That's for me the advantage of doing this in that way. Now it's not minus, it's plus beta sum over I lambda I si minus mi. So since this is only a formal inversion, I don't do this in the beginning, I can do this only afterwards. So I start with the omegas, lambda I si minus mi. Now this is an interacting Hamiltonian. And you know what we can do with interacting Hamiltonians, we just put it in the single particle basis. The trace is then only a sum over single particle states. We get products of all these things. So what's coming out, this minus 1 over beta. Again, this lambda I, mi is just a number, so you can put it through the trace, and you have sum over I minus beta lambda I mi. That's this part here. Plus logarithm trace e to the beta sum I si lambda I. That's the other part. Now this can be simplified. Let's put the whole one. So you take this sum, you write it as a product of exponential functions. So you have a product of e to the beta si lambda I. And here you have the trace. But the trace is only a sum over all possible configurations si in your lattice, in your original problem. That's still a many-body basis. That's your original lattice. Now you can exchange these two things by writing that the product and the sum runs now only off over the single particle states. So this runs only from minus 1 to plus 1, e to the beta si lambda I. This is easy. This is the hyperbolic cosine. And the product gives you, yeah, you have here the logarithm that you need still. Logarithm of the product is the sum of the logarithm. And at the end of the day, you have sum over I logarithm 2 cosine beta lambda I. So you see the dynamic variable s disappeared because we did all the sum, we did the trace, this is gone, and we have this. This you know from statistical physics. That's nothing else. Oh, this is related. It's the partition function for non-interacting spins. So you have seen this in your studies, I hope. Okay, but still we have this part here. So putting this together, we can write omega as, now I'm not supposed to lose any term, sum over I. This beta here cancels. So you have lambda I mi. And this you keep minus 1 over beta, I guess, yes. Logarithm 2 cosine, the hyperbolic cosine of beta lambda I. And here, this sum goes over all this. Okay, now, yes? It's a functional, so you will see the way we constructed it. Since this is omega, it's, if you go to zero temperature, it's the free energy, in a way. So we call it gamma, but it's the free energy functional at the end of the day. Where did I put this stuff there? So here, as I said in the beginning, here are still these lambdas. These are these Lagrange multipliers, so we have to get rid of them. And the way to get rid of them is to look for the stationary solution. And the stationary solution means I look for d omega over d lambda I. This should be equal to 0. And if you do this, you see you do the derivative with respect to lambda I, so the sum goes away. So you get mi. And here you get 1 over hyperbolic cosine. Then the internal thing is this hyperbolic sine, so you get the hyperbolic tangents. And this condition, if you do the math, ends up with this beta lambda j, I give this an index, is equal to mj. And this equation you know. That's the mean field equation for the Ising model. So you see you can derive this mean field equation for the Ising model from a functional and just requiring that this is stationary, that you go to the saddle point of this functional and that gives you the solution. Now, In that case, we will see this is not the case later, but in that case, this inversion is easy to get the lambdas as function of mu. Because here you just say lambda j is the 1 over beta and the inverse function of mj. So given the m's, imposing the m's from outside, so to say, you can express these Lagrange parameters as function of the m's and put it back into your omega. That's the standard way how you do these things in math. And by doing this, this I leave as an exercise because doing this all the way requires a little bit of calculations. You end up with this gamma 0, that's alpha equal to 0, and that is 1 over beta, sum I, and then you have 1 plus mi over 2 logarithm 1 plus mi over 2 plus the term that's 1 minus mi over 2 logarithm 1 minus mi over 2. And that's the entropy of this system. It's an entropy term. It's p log p for the things, for the states that you have in your system. Okay, this is the equivalent problem. That's the single spin without interactions. So we want something that has no SI, SJ term, but is just a single spin in some effective medium. The effective medium we have still to define. And the effective medium is defined by this equation. So this lambda I, J, this is the Weiss field. The Lagrange multiplier is the Weiss field of the problem. So we can write this beta H.
Mm-hmm. So the Weiss field is the field created by the other spin. It's the mean field. If you are putting the interaction to be completely zero, where from this Weiss field is getting created?
No, now you have to be careful. We will see how this H effective looks like as
no, but the
created
H
by the other spins.
Yeah, but the H effective should have the J term because
we will see how this appears. At this point, the H effective is some effective field that gives you the correct magnetization. We did not specify how this H effective relies on J so far.
No, if you said alpha equal to zero, then there is no interaction between the spins at all.
No, then because then it's a pure entropy term.
Okay.
So now we have to do this coupling constant integration and by taking the mean field part of this, the mean field part of this coupling constant integration, you add the mean field term and that the J appears.
That I understand.
Yeah.
So this is what this is the land of free energy function.
Yes.
Of a paramagnet.
Okay.
So if you optimize this, you will get M equal to zero.
Yes, this will give you M equal to zero.
See, spontaneous M will be zero.
Okay.
But once you put in interactions, that will pick up some. So what he's doing is he's starting from the microscopics and deriving a land of free energy.
Yes.
So this gamma naught can be thought of as a land of free energy.
Okay.
Let's just let me write down this formula. This is defining the effective field. So given the MIs, I'm not, if I optimize this that I said, no, it disappeared. This thing, or taking this and requiring this to be zero, this will give you the physical solution. If I do this here, it will come out M is equal to zero. That means the effective field is equal to zero. We have a paramagnet, so everything is fine. It's still non-interacting spins. Okay. And this you have to box on your notes because this is defining the effective field. That's the way how the effective field relies on the M is defined by the choice of your equivalent problem. You choose a single spin in an effective medium, so the effective field will always be given by this formula. Always. This you have to remember. Okay, now let's do this step to go away from this alpha equal to zero. And let's see how interactions come in and how we get these approximate solutions. So now we go from alpha equals to 0 to alpha equal to 1. And this we do by this coupling constant integration. So we can say gamma for alpha equal to 1 as function of all this mi is gamma of alpha equal to 0 plus the integral from 0 to 1. And now we write it as d alpha. Here the derivative with respect to alpha, that's it. It depends also on the m, of course. So formally, we get the thing at alpha equal to 1, starting from some initial point and integrating all the way to the alpha equal to 1 Hamiltonian, that's the original Hamiltonian. Okay, so we need this property. So we can calculate this from the definition. This gamma depends on alpha through this H alpha. So this is d over d alpha of minus 1 over beta logarithm trace e to the minus beta H alpha plus beta sum over I, lambda I Si minus Mi. And now you see what happens if you take the derivative with alpha. So you get the factor that's associated with alpha down, and you get the expectation value. That's why this is a very useful concept. That taking derivatives with this, it's like a source term in a way. You get this down, and you get the expectation value. So this is nothing else than the expectation value of H. And now not H alpha, but H, the original Hamiltonian. That's J I J times S I times S J. But with a Hamiltonian or with an action or whatever, you define this, this expectation value where the lambdas are still inside. And this Hamiltonian that is defining your Boltzmann weights also has the alpha. So we should not forget that there is an alpha and a lambda still in the Hamiltonian. So it's not H, it's not the energy. It's not taken with the original Hamiltonian. It's something else. Okay, so this can be written as minus sum ij, I took a j ij, s I s j, and expectation value of this guy. We will see that, okay, in the end, what you get back, if you don't integrate to 1, you don't get back your original Hamiltonian. So then you get another Hamiltonian, and we will see that this term, it's exactly the term that then we neglect when you do mean field. But you should go to 1 to connect to your original problem. If you go to, I don't know if, is there any meaning to this if you don't go to 1? I don't think so. For the intermediate steps, if there is any meaning. I mean, physically, no. I mean, no.
But what's the use of having all the alphas? Then just have the alpha equal to 1.
Just 0 and 1, then fine.
What do you mean is the use? It's just connecting the alpha equals 0 to alpha equal to 1. I connect my system, which I define to be my equivalent system, which in that sense is one spin in effective medium, with my original Hamiltonian. And I have to do this in some way. And I choose to do it in this way.
Why don't we just discretely pick one? What is the requirement of the
state? Oh, you ask me questions. That's a...
like integral by starting point and end point, which can be as bad as can be. So you have to do it in infinitesimal steps. In order to ensure adiabaticity in that case.
Yeah.
Otherwise.
Yeah, okay. My remark was in the same sense as Thomas. So since we will use this after lunch still, exercise for the lunch break, find an expression for the functional only using alpha equal 0 and 1.
Yeah.
If you succeed, we will change the lecture this afternoon.
Okay. Okay, so yeah, we are almost there. So the only thing we still have here is the expectation value of these dynamic variables. So as I told you, we want to have something that contains the mean field value. So we don't take the expectation value of the dynamic variable, but we just rewrite it mathematically. And this we can do by introducing these connected correlators. Let's call it that way. I put it here. Let's give them some symbol. There's no meaning to this. That depends, of course, on all the m's and all the alphas. And this should be not this correlation function, but the one where you subtract your mean field value, so to say. So it's si minus mi. This is an I, not a j, times sj minus mj. So you have seen these objects, I think, in your many body theory lectures. So this is a connected correlation function. And of course, this has a term that goes like si dot sj, but it also has a term like mi dot mj. And mi dot mj will be exactly the mean field contribution. So using this object, we can rewrite this d gamma alpha, the derivative of d alpha, in the following way. We write it as minus sum ij jij, but now I take here mi mj, so only the mean these two numbers here. They're still not the mean field values. They're just numbers, mi and mj. And put another thing like sum over ij, jij, and then this object here, ij, depending on all these m's and on alpha. So you can just insert this equation here. You will see there's nothing wrong. No term is missing, no term is more. This is an exact expression. Okay, so we are almost there. So now you see what we did ended up in a very nice splitting up of terms, because we can write now our gamma, the one at alpha equal to 1, which depends on all this mi, as our gamma 0. And this gamma 0 is the one that we wrote here, this we have, minus sum over ij, jij, mi, mj, is this term. Now I lost an integral somewhere. The integral should, no. Okay. Yes, let me see. Where did this integral go? Huh? Yeah, it's here. No, the problem is I should not have the integral here, so I wonder where I have to lose it. Let's write another term, because the next term, I screwed it up somewhere. But the thing should look like this. There is the integral from 0 to 1, d alpha, and here you have the gij, depending on alpha. So this is the integral.
But
the first term has no alpha. Yeah, that's right. So that the integral is trivial. That's right. So I didn't screw it up. I just was not thinking enough. Okay, so this is the expression that we finally got. And now you can identify the terms properly. So you see, this is what we just said correctly. It's the power magnet, fluctuating spins, no correlations, no nothing, just an entropy term. This is the mean field contribution to the interactions. And this is all the rest. Everything else that we don't know. And that, if you remember, is kind of the philosophy that you heard in DFT. You know, you take this and this, and everything that you don't know, you put in this XC correlation potential. And you will see that you can formulate this exactly the same way. Okay, what we still have to do, or what we should do, is to get the equilibrium condition. So what you do now is you take this and you do d gamma over dmi and require this to be zero. And get that gives you now the connection of the m's being the mean field or the equilibrium solution of the expectation value of the SI. So I just repeat mean field theory here, lengthy. You know all this. It's just maybe a different formalism of looking at things. So let me do this. Now I reuse the formula that I wrote down here. So you can take your notes. So you see the first term is gamma zero. So we have to do the variation of this gamma zero with respect to the MIs. So what you end up with is, I don't do this. It's pretty simple math. You have MI, 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 MI. You have to do the product rule of all these derivatives. And then you end up at the term that is 1 over beta, 1 half, and then the plus is 1i divided by 1 minus MI. Now, if you look up this at Wikipedia or somewhere, or you know it by heart, this is nothing but the inverse of the hyperbolic tangents. Oops, of MI. So you see, we have already again obtained this hyperbolic tangent. Okay, that's the gamma zero term. Now, this was the tricky part because all the other things are easy. This, the derivative of this with respect to 1 MI is what? It's sum over J, JIJ, MJ. The MI disappeared. We took the derivative of this. And this we don't touch. We don't know. So we cannot calculate the derivative of a function that we don't know. So putting all this together leads us to, we take the thing that we had there, 1 over beta hyperbolic tangent of MI. Here we get minus sum over J, JIJ, MJ. And I take just something like this. Because I don't know what it is, I call this object the correlation part of this function, whatever it is. And we should take the derivative with respect to all this MI. Now, this has to be zero. And you can write this in a slightly different way, in a way that you are familiar with, that this MI star, that's now this equilibrium value, is, where's the beta? It's inside. It's okay. Beta times sum I, no, sum J, J I J M J star plus minus this term DM. And you might have realized that up to this point, there was no approximation. This is an exact theory. So I unfortunately erased the equation that I had here. But there was this relation between the field, between the M's and the Weiss field. And if you look up what it is, then this is nothing else than your effective Weiss field. That's the definition of the effective Weiss field. And up to the, excuse me? MI star, I just call the value of M that fulfills this condition M star. That's the saddle point value, M star. Or I write that this is M, but at the point where d gamma over dm is equal to zero. Let's call this M star, the value of M that fulfills this condition. Now, we have this, and you might guess what mean field approximation means. Mean field approximation means, let's forget about this guy. The thing that we don't know, we don't calculate, and that's exactly mean field, the mean field approximation. So you see, starting from this functional, doing all this math, you end up exactly at this mean field contribution, but to some extent you know what you neglected. And there are ways of calculating this gamma correlation, so you can go beyond mean field, you can do fluctuation expansions around your saddle point and so on. But I don't want to go into the business of this. I just wanted to show you how to derive these mean field equations.
I have one question.
Yeah.
What is the condition of extremizing gamma with respect to MIs? Why do I need to do here?
Ah, here.
Why do I need to extremize gamma with respect to MIs? What is that condition exactly?
I mean, since this is a free energy, we want to, it's actually a minimum.
Okay.
So you minimize your free energy.
So
because at this point, maybe I was not clear enough, at this point where we started, the MI were some external fields, mm-hmm. some external parameters that we put into these derivations,
mm-hmm.
and now we require this functional to be minimal.
So actually, you can view the lambdas as external fields that you put in to fix this. And when you went from the functional of MI to function of lambda I, d by d of this new functional by MI is actually equal to lambda I for any generic lambda I. So you want external fields to be zero. So that's that condition.
Yeah.
External fields are zero.
Okay.
I mean, okay, this has to do with this Legendre transforms. You see, if you have two functionals that are related to each other through Legendre transforms, then you have, for instance, now d gamma over dm is lambda, and the other functional, which is omega, is then d omega over d lambda is minus m, plus minus, depending on how you do it. So now you require one of these to be zero. That gives you the condition of d gamma over dm has to be zero. It's this,
so
if I'm not completely wrong.
Yeah,
no,
yeah.
Okay, good. So that was mean field theory for the spin, and we spent already quite a long time on this. Now, I want to briefly show you how to do this for DFT, because then we end up with the DFT functional that is one half of the LDA plus DMFT functional. Because we don't know it. So, in principle, that's exactly, again, this statement. If somebody tells you exactly this guy, you have here an exact equation, and then you can solve everything. You can calculate all correlation functions and so on from this functional representation. But we don't know it. So that's why either you do approximations to it, so you try to do expansions. This you can do with susceptibilities and so on. Or you neglect it completely, and then it's mean field. So I know this is maybe a little bit, I would not say boring, but a little bit hard to follow. I mean, if you hear this the first time, it's really kicking you out. But it's a very useful concept. And Silke will use this also in the afternoon, so it's quite good that you hear this. So DFT, you can formulate in a very similar manner. And there you do the following. You introduce this H alpha to be the kinetic Hamiltonian. Now I use this language of second quantization. So these are these field of the operators that you basically one-year functions plus dx, vx, and x. So this is the kinetic term. This is the crystal potential. It's some potential interacting with the electron density. And now we have another term And here we put the alpha, which is dr dr prime nr. And then let's just write it as 1 over r minus r prime nr prime. So this is the electron-electron interaction in your Hamiltonian. And now we do the same thing, that the interacting part of the Hamiltonian we dress with this coupling constant alpha. And now you see here it's a bit different because we have a H0 and an H interacting, and only one of these two things we want to set to 0. So the we have to do the same exercise as before, by because this here operators. So the operator n of x is psi dagger x psi of x. So that's the density operator. But still we want to, as in DFT, we want to enforce at the end of the day the density that we calculate to be the density of the crystal. So we again introduce this Lagrange multipliers, and we write omega alpha now as a function of n of x and lambda of x to be minus 1 over beta trace logarithm. It's basically the same thing as before, e to the minus beta h alpha. And now let's put the sign correctly, plus beta integral dx lambda x times, I put first this nx minus n hat of x. So this additional term is again a Lagrange multiplying field now. It's not a number, it's a field. But this ensures that by taking the stationary point with lambda, n of x, the density that we give, is equal to the expectation value of this operator n of x. That's again, it's the same, exactly the same concept. So now we can rewrite this again as before to split this term off. That is just lambda times n. And we write this as minus 1 over beta lambda trace exponential function of minus beta h. Let's look at alpha equal to 0 here. Alpha equal to 0 minus dx lambda x. But here, let's write only the operator. And the other thing can be taken out of this exponential, lambda x n x, because this is not an operator. This is a complex, no, not even a complex number. It should be a real number. You can take this out. And it is again this f minus mi lambda I, basically. It's the same term. And now this closes here. For a non-interacting Hamiltonian, this is alpha equal to 0, there are no interactions, we can evaluate this. And this can, there is a, I don't do this in detail, but you can use the formalism that Vijay showed you by writing this trace of exponential value. It's the partition function. You write this in path integral formalism with Gaussian with Grassmann variables. Basically, what you end up is a d c depends on c and c dagger. So this path integral exponential function 0 to beta d tau c dagger tau, and then you have minus d tau plus no, let's keep the original notation. So we have some kinetic, I just write it formally. A kinetic term, some potential term, and we have also this lambda term that we should not forget as C of tau, but that's it. There's no interaction. And you see that at the end of the day, what this is nothing that the G, the Green's function to the minus 1. And now you have a Grassmann Gaussian integral. So this is e to the c dagger g c. And for this, you can use the standard formula. So you get nothing else than the determinant of g to the minus 1. Now here you have still the logarithm of the determinant. You go back to linear algebra. You, by inverting this, you get the trace of the logarithm of g, and this is a term you might have encountered already. That's the free energy of a non-interacting system. So by using this equation, we can write omega for alpha equal to zero as minus 1 over beta, the trace of the logarithm of, now I put the thing, the Green's function in Matsubara frequencies, I can do this, minus the kinetic term, minus the potential term, minus this lambda term, and here we have dx, lambda x, and x. Now, remember what we did for the Ising spins. This is an equation where we have now to take the derivative of this, and by taking the derivative, we get the condition for n as function of lambda, and then we have to invert this. But in that case, this is not so easily done. Let's first take the derivative. The derivative means n of x is equal to the n of x I get from here. So we take now the functional derivative, so all these integrals, they pop out. So n of x is equal to the derivative of this with respect to lambda. This is a logarithm, so you get the 1 over this. And the trace, so we put the trace, some expectation value of it. And we take the expectation value in x to be here in the Reed space representation. But this is nothing else than 1 over I omega minus t minus v minus lambda. But this is the expectation value of the Green's function. And the problem is, this is not invertible analytically. You cannot write now lambda is a function of n or so. This you cannot do. So since you cannot do this analytically, you have to do this iteratively normally. That is why you do contram equations iteratively, basically. Okay. But let's assume we can invert this formally. We have a way to do this. Then we can write... do we need this? Yeah, I should introduce the contram potential at some point. Let's do it in that way. Let's assume we can invert this. This is just a formal step. And we find lambda x as function of n of x. Then we write this as, this doesn't change, minus trace lambda. Now the beta is missing. Lambda I omega minus t minus v minus this lambda, but this depends on n here, minus dx lambda, that depends on n times n of x. This is the formal inversion of this thing. What we now do is we call this was all calculated at alpha equal to zero, we call this lambda the Concham potential minus the crystal potential. That's a formal introduction of the Concham potential. It's just giving this lambda zero, these external fields, a name. And we subtract this, it's a formal thing. Yes? Omega is the same as gamma, with the one difference that gamma depends only on n. It's a formal difference. That we inverted all the equations to express lambda as function of n, and then you have to insert what you got here in this equation, in principle, and then you have gamma as function only of n and not of these source fields, of these Lagrange multipliers here. Lambda is not an operator. Ah, no, let me see. No. Okay, you can insert this here, and that is the introduction of the Concham potential. It's just another name for this lambda zero, for this constraining field that we had in this initial where am I now? On the wrong page here. Ah, okay. Okay, that's the expression for gamma equal to zero. We don't do anything more to it. Now we have here some trace logarithm t part, which is nice. And here we have already some expression for the contrarian potential. It's all formally inserted. We don't know really what to do with it. But we will see what it is when we do this coupling constant integration. I always lose this. Maybe I would like to use this again. So as before, we write now gamma as functional of n to be gamma of 0 of n plus this integral from 0 to 1 d alpha d gamma alpha over d alpha. That's the same thing as before. Now you can do the same thing as before, calculate the derivative of gamma with alpha. And what happens is, you see here, taking the derivative with alpha brings this object down in the trace, and it's again the expectation value. So it's, if we call this here the electron-electron interaction, then this is the expectation value of this electron-electron interaction, but for a given, let's say, n of x, lambda of x, which depends on n also. So this is, again, the expectation value of this interacting part, same as before. And now you might guess what we do. Here we have a term n dot n, which is, again, just operator times operator and the expectation value of this. So we again introduce this connected expectation values. So we introduce the same thing. Let's call it GC. And this should be operator n minus n. Now there need to be indices also. This should be x minus n of x times n of x prime minus n of x prime. Like this. Where this is the operator and this is this field that we require in the, from the beginning. And with this term, I write it here, I can again split up or split off several terms. I can write this gamma as the gamma zero, sorry, plus what I call now the Hartree, plus something that I call gamma xc, which depends on n of x. And if you take these formulas, then you see that the Hartree term is nothing else than exactly this, but not taking operators, but taking the electron densities. So that's 1 half integral n of x prime divided by x minus x prime. So that's the Hartree energy. Gamma zero is this term plus this, so you can take this. And this we don't know. It's again the same principle as before. And that's now this exchange correlation energy that we don't know. So what DFT is doing is not, let's put it the other way, if you neglect this completely, you get Hartree theory. If you do some approximations to this, you get more than that, and that's then LDA approximation to this term, the GGA approximation to this term, meta-GGA approximations to this term, and so on. But you approximate exactly this function that you don't know. That's the idea. Okay, now we have gamma. What we still have to do is this is one important step that you do in this whole calculation. So you require the gamma to be minimal with respect to the density. So it should be a function of the density in equilibrium. It should be a minimum because it's a thermodynamic potential. If you do this, you get from here, you see you have a lambda 0 dot n. So you get the lambda 0, a minus actually. And this minus lambda 0, you can express with this contrarian potential and the VC. That's just the definition of the contrarian potential that I used. So this is minus V contrarian minus the crystal potential plus integral dx prime. So we have now only x prime because this was the function that we took the functional derivative with. And we have n x prime, and here x minus x prime, the Coulomb potential, plus something again that we don't know. Oops. And if we write this a little bit different, then we can see that we have V contrarian of x equals to V of x plus Hartree term plus d gamma xc over dn, and that depends on n. And this, if you go back to your notes of DFT or LDA, this is just the contrarian potential as you define it in your contrarian equations. So we derive from this very general functional the contrarian equations by requiring that this functional has to be minimal at the solution, the physical solution for the density. That's nothing else than the self-consistency condition in mean field that connects the surrounding spins to this single isolated spins and giving this effective path. It's exactly the same concept. Only that mean field would mean we completely neglect this. In DFT, we do approximations to this term, like LDA, for instance. Okay. Now, in the last 15 minutes or so, I want to introduce a DMFT functional. So I hope you still can follow this. This will be now a bit more like just introducing it, not so much deriving it, because that's the Baim-Cardanov functional, and I don't want to derive this. I just write it down. This we keep. There is a famous functional in many body theory that's Latinger Ward and Baim-Cardanov. So we can write the free energy of a system as minus trace logarithm of I omega n. Let's put here some chemical potential to have all the terms delta ij. That's how you find it in textbooks. Minus the self-energy ij of omega, minus the trace over sigma dot g, plus, and what's written here is the Latin-Ward functional that depends on the Green's function. So I don't derive this. Just take it as given and take it as granted. The nice thing about this Latin-Ward functional is that this functional is used to construct so-called conserving approximations. So as soon as you can relate theories with your Latin-Ward functional, you have conserving approximations, and everybody wants to have these kind of theories. So what it means is that if you take the derivative of pi with g, then you get the self-energy with plus or minus with plus, depending on g. So the derivative of the Latin-Ward functional is the self-energy. And this is not the Dyson equation that's important. The Dyson equation is something different. That's a functional connection between the Green's function and the self-energy. Okay, I don't want to go so much into the details of this, but what I want to show is that you can derive DMFT by a very simple approximation to this. That means making this local. This, who knows these diagrammatic expansions? Maybe not so many people. But this is just a sum of all kinds of diagrams that you can imagine. And the G are all kinds of Green's functions that you can imagine. It's just summing all skeleton diagrams, to be precise. Now, making this local gives you exactly DMFT. So you place this by the sum of local Latentia Ward functionals. Or you take only the local parts of this, sum it, of course, to get all these local contributions. And then that's the so-called DMFT Baim-Cardanov approximation. So Baim-Cardanov functional where you get DMFT. In that sense, it's quite simple. And if you write down now this gamma, DMFT, I'm running out of time, so. Let's just put it again like this, trace logarithm. Now you have here the Green's function. But here it's, no, let's put it. I omega plus mu minus Tij minus sigma depends on G by this. So you would have d phi d Gij minus trace d phi d G times G. And then you have this DMFT GII functionals. You saw this, I think, yesterday in the talk by Andy Millis, who also gave a general introduction to this functional formulation of DMFT. That's, I think, very much what he did yesterday. So that's why I don't go into much detail of this. So the idea, that's now maybe the last page that I want to put here. The idea is now to combine what we have here, this, with this DMFT functional to get an LDA plus DMFT functional that, taking all these derivatives in a similar sense like this, you take the derivative with the density should give you the Concham equation. Taking derivative with the sigma then should give you Dyson equation and all this. That is the idea. So how can we do this? Now I need a bit more space. Oh, okay, thank you. Okay. So we want to have, now I have to go to the box. We want to construct this LDA plus DMFT functional, and this should depend on, let's call it now rho and g. It should depend on the density of your crystal and on the local Green's function. In DFT, we had only this. Okay, how can we do this? We take the same formulas as before, but I call now n rho and so on to be consistent with what you can find in papers. You can find expressions like this, that we have rho and g, and the fields that we had before, it was lambda, but lambda can be expressed from the Concham potential. That's just another word, basically. And the corresponding field for G is sigma, you will find. I will show you why this has to be like this. And then we take an expression like this, omega n plus mu plus the kinetic term. Let's write it. Burp squared minus the crystal potential. No, the Concham must be here. Minus the self-energy. And now let's write me the self-energy in a way that it's connected with what I told you yesterday, that you have the same language. It's, I call it P star delta sigma P. I will write down what this means. Just take this as the formula. Then minus a term that we had before that was lambda dot n, just written in the definitions that we have. Then we have a term dr prime rho of r, the electron-electron interaction r minus r prime rho of r prime, and that doesn't fit here, so that's a very long formula. The thing which was gamma xc, let's call it energy xc. Normally it's called the exchange correlation energy, so we use the symbol E. So that's, except for this term, it's the DFT functional that we had. We put this there also. And now we add a few more terms, that is trace of delta sigma G, that's coming from here. And we add these Latin Chabot functionals, phi, phi impurity of G. And here I add another thing, that's the double counting. I formally add it here. The double counting correction that we discussed yesterday, that there is some energy that you would calculate twice, so you have to subtract it. So we have no idea what phi of double counting is. The condition that we have to put is that d phi double counting, the derivative is g, this is this double counting sigma that they introduced yesterday. So that is the definition of phi to some extent. So we put the double counting here. Okay. Now I want to show you that this definition, this is a lengthy definition, but that taking the derivative of this with respect to the Conchon potential and the Green's function gives you exactly the Conchon equation, and the stationary point is the, should I do this? It takes a lot of time. Okay, you can try this at home. You take the derivative of this with respect to sigma, and then you see you get the Dyson equation. You take the derivatives with respect to rho, and with respect to the Conchon, and you get back the Conchon equations and the self-consistency conditions. So that's the LDA plus DMFT functional. That gives you the correct equations to get the equilibrium state.
Provided you give me by DCL.
Excuse me?
Provided you give me the functional by DCL. You
know? This one?
You have to give me that functional. Okay. There is no way to derive that functional. That by.
I don't know. I don't think so, because that's externally put in, yeah.
So you have to, somebody has to specify that.
No, I specify only the derivative.
Okay.
Or this is a bit hand waving because I specify that it should be here as a in this formula. I just know what is the energy and the functional related to this phi in a way. Because at the end of the day, what you get, I mean, taking the derivative with V of Ks and sigma formally allows you to eliminate these two things, and then you can write this this omega as just functional of rho of G. So that's exactly the same thing that we did before. Taking derivatives, using the what you get out of it to formally, you never do this in practice, to formally invert these equations and to write down gamma as functional only of rho and G. So all this is a bit mathematical, but that is how it works. And now what you can do with this is that, okay, where are we now? Yeah. This is such a long formula. It's a bit difficult to grasp. We want to relate this to something that we know, because we want to calculate some things of it, the total energy of our system. So what we can do is, this is basically g, the interacting Green's function that we get from our DMFT solution. This is the self-energy that's related to the DMFT solution. We put this into our problem. This is the non-interacting Hamiltonian, so that's the Dyson equation to get g. Here we have something that looks like DFT. Here's something that looks like DFT. And this also belongs to DFT. So maybe we can express this as the energy of DFT. What we have to do is to add a term that is minus trace logarithm, but the Concham energy, so the DFT thing of this, and add it again. That's a sums to zero, but that means we can take one of these, add it to this, and to this, and to this, and this defines the DFT energy, if you look at the previous page in your notes. So we can write this as the DFT energy. Now I still have to put this trace logarithm G Concham. This I introduced here, so I have to get rid of it again. But then still I have this term. This didn't disappear. So I have minus trace logarithm G. Then I have this term which has this sigma dot G. Delta sigma dot G. Now, there is another term which I'm missing here. That's the double counting. No, yeah, I forgot to put it. There is also a term that is has a similar form as this, because we need this to get the Legendre transform. So we write this sigma minus delta sigma double count. I'm stupid. The double counting is in the delta sigma, of course. Delta sigma, you go back to the lecture of yesterday, is sigma minus sigma double counting. Yeah, it's there. Okay, no problem. No problem. So we have it. Let's just write it out explicitly. So we have trace sigma of the impurity, g of the impurity minus, no, this has to be a plus, trace of the double counting value times g of the impurity. And then come the two phi, where one is the double counting, one is the impurity. Okay, and that's basically what we have to use to calculate the total energy in LDA plus DMFT. And it's a bit, I don't derive this now, but this is nothing else than the expectation value of the interacting Hamiltonian minus the double counting energy. That's, in a sense, the inverse to define this phi to get back this double counting energy. But now you have this difference. I want to write down this equation because you have to see this difference. This is the energy of DFT. Now what you would do if you just close your eyes and you don't do these calculations, you take the energy that you get from DFT, you add the interaction energies that you got in your impurity Hamiltonian, and you subtract your double counting energy. That would be the poor man's approach to this. The point is, that's not fully self-consistent because that does not, that is not the expression at the saddle point of this functional. At the saddle point of the functional, that means also this expression for the Concham energy has to be evaluated at the LDA plus DMFT density. So also the density has to be updated to get the correct expression for the, if you forget this, that would be one shot LDA plus DMFT. And exactly this difference is the full self-consistent LDA plus DMFT approach to evaluate also the Concham equations at the true LDA plus TMFT density. That's a very lengthy approach to derive these equations, I admit, so I hope that you could follow at least to the end. And that is the equation that is implemented in the codes. So you use this equation to calculate the total energy of your system. And with this, I want to stop. That was more than enough, I think, with all these equations. And if you have questions, we can discuss this later. Don't forget this immediately, because you will need this after lunch. At least to know what is a functional derivative. You will see this GW functional and so on. So I know it's already the end of the school, but stay with us a little bit more. Okay, thank you. A proper reference? Who? I will collect them and I will give it to you because I don't have it in my mind. But it's not so much in textbooks, this whole thing. So Silke, she has also...
Actually, I would recommend lecture notes that Antoine Georges put up on archive in 2004.
Exactly.
There's some very nice writing up, like 50 pages.
I basically followed his lecture notes from there. There's another... But that are then original papers, which are a bit more difficult to read with not all the details. But these lecture notes of Antoine Georges, this was a Lesouche summer school, 2004. Antoine Georges. And it's something like called LDA, or the dynamical mean field theory lecture notes from a school or so, 50 pages. It's not only this, it's a very nice introduction to DMFT, to materials, to the mod transition, to this concept, so I can recommend this. Okay, so let's have lunch.